Fortunate are the people who do not have civilization-destroying neighbors. The Armenians, however, cannot be ranked among those happy nations because of various Turkic tribes which penetrated into their homeland from regions as remote as Altai over 1,000 years ago. One of the oldest and most famous cities of historical Armenia, Julfa, used to lie on the left bank of the river Arax in Yerenjak district. Movses Khorenatsi, the father of Armenian historiography, was the first to make reference to Julfa as an Armenian township as early as the 5th century. Julfa is recorded in many historical foreign sources documenting it as an Armenian territory. The city used to have a great number of scriptoria. The oldest of the manuscripts date from 1286. Julfa had several stages of development. The last stage traces back to the early 15th century, when some of the inhabitants of the medieval Armenian capital of Ani resettled in Julfa after the fall of their own city. Half of them escaped to Van and Julfa. The others settled wherever they could. As attested by John Newberry in 1581, Julfa had a population of 3,000 houses. In the late 16th century, the splendid city was considered the magnificent capital of Armenia. Luis Pereira de la Serta, Portugal's ambassador to Persia, visited Julfa on the eve of its residents' deportation by Shah Abbas in 1604. He wrote, "Julfa, lying within 3 jornatas of Tabriz, is a large Armenian city with no Muslim inhabitants." While deporting Julfa Armenians for the purpose of developing trade and crafts in his country, Shah Abbas was assisted by Tahmazvuli, a Georgian prince of Somkhet, who had converted to Islam. According to the Shah's order, Julfa Armenians were given only 3 days to leave the city. Those staying thereafter the deadline were threatened with death. The deportees had to cross the river quickly, without sufficient number of boats. As a result, a great number of people drowned. However, that was not the only calamity to befall Julfa Armenians. Shah Abbas called for Tahmazvuli Bey and asked, "Have you not burned down the buildings of the city after the deportation of the residents?" Receiving a negative answer, he ordered that the Bey return and do so. In the spring of the following year, the Persians invaded Julfa for the last time to finally get rid of the remaining Armenian refugees who had managed to escape the deportation. 68 years after the forced displacement of Julfa Armenians, in 1673, French knight Jean Chardin visited Julfa and wrote the following about it. "On the bank of the Arax River, the destroyed city of Old Julfa is located. It has been annihilated beyond recognition, but even the ruins are not able to conceal the magnificence it once enjoyed. It used to lie on the steep slope of a mountain. Many castles protected the entrances to the city that were naturally fortified and difficult to access. As attested by the Armenians, it comprised 4,000 houses, all of which now lie in ruins. The city that offers an attractive view resembles a long amphitheater. At present, it is inhabited by only 30 families, all of them Armenian." Shah Abbas the Great reduced Julfa to total ruins. William Owsley, an English diplomat who visited Julfa in 1812, writes, "We saw the remnants of Julfa, now an annihilated city, lying amidst beautiful rocks and mountains. It is situated on a bank of the Arax, with the remains of a castle and a small tower nearby. I studied the main ruins of Julfa carefully. In the vicinity of an ancient church, a fine tombstone, engraved with some reliefs and an Armenian epitaph, was preserved. From a nearby elevation, I took a photograph of what was once a bridge extending over the river Arax below the city. Madame Chantre, a French investigator who visited the ruins of Julfa in 1890, writes, "All the local remarkable buildings have fallen prey to fire and have been demolished. It is difficult at present to form a mental picture of the original city." In 1894, the world-famous encyclopedia of Brockhaus Yeffron wrote that the only remnants of the city, which once claimed 50,000 inhabitants, now comprised ruins of houses and churches, as well as a large cemetery and the foundations of some two or three bridges lying over the river Arax. Julfa used to boast 9 churches and monasteries, which were as follows: Saint Ovanes, Saint Gevork, Saint Minas, Saint Hagop, Saint Andriordi, Surp Asvazadzin, Holy Virgin, Surp Amenapergich, Holy Savior, Surp Yerortutyun, Holy Trinity, Orverin Upper Katan, and Pomblos Jam, Pomblos Church. Although Shah Abbas deported Julfa Armenians and devastated the city, he did not touch the local cemetery extending over 3 hills on the bank of the Arax River in the southwest of the city. The ancient cemetery was a unique specimen of Armenian cultural heritage, which occupied a special place in the treasury of world civilization. French researcher Alexander de Rhodes, who visited the site of the city 43 years after its fall in 1648, saw 10,000 standing, ornate khachkars, cross stones, there. By the early 20th century, their number had dropped to about 6,000 only, including some ram-shaped tombstones. The cemetery also retained 2 churches and a chapel. As William Owsley writes, that large cemetery, comprising rows of a huge number of standing gravestones that resemble densely arrayed soldiers from afar, is living proof of the number of people the city formerly enjoyed. They perpetuate the memory of many generations, constituting the overall result of many centuries of creative work. Robert Kerr Porter, an English artist and archaeologist who visited Julfa in 1819, describes the cemetery in the following manner: 3 hills densely covered with graves lying within a foot of each other, long vertical stones, some of them between 8 and 10 feet high. You can hardly find a single one that is not skillfully engraved with various reliefs representing crosses, saints, angels, birds, animals, etc. It would not be an exaggeration to say that this cemetery of the ancient Armenian people contains thousands of outstanding gravestones. In the same year, Mesrop Taryadians wrote, "The deceased inhabitants of Julfa tell you even more about their ancestors' glory than those alive. The reliefs and motifs of their gravestones, as well as their numerous splendid epitaphs, are well worth of being recorded in the history of art." World-famous artist Mardiro Sarian, who visited the cemetery in 1914, writes, "I was amazed at the unsurpassed artistic value of the khachkars, as well as the wonderful variety marking their reliefs. In the meantime, however, I was shocked to see that some of them had been broken during the construction of the railway. In September 1915, Scottish linguist and archaeologist Nicholas Marr gave an assignment to photographer Aram Varuir to work in the cemetery. In 1928, Lithuanian art historian Jurgis Baltrušaitis conducted research there. The tombstones of Julfa Cemetery fall into three groups. The first group includes the period between the 9th and 13th centuries. The second one, the 14th and 15th centuries. And the third embraces the time span between the early 16th century and the year 1605. All the khachkars are carved of pink and yellowish stone. Having equal width from top to bottom, they are between 2 and 2.5 meters high. Their central parts are more deeply cut. The crosses and two-layer reliefs creating a peculiar contrast between light and shade. The cornices of the khachkars often bear the representation of Christ, the evangelists, and Holy Virgin. Below the cross, a finely carved rosette and the branches of a tree of life can be seen, while the lower part of the stone is engraved with an epitaph and a relief representing the deceased person. The cemetery was an eloquent witness to Julfa Armenia's glorious past. In the Soviet years, the cemetery became part of the territory of Nakhichevan, which had been annexed to the Republic of Azerbaijan. The Monuments Preservation Department of that country absolutely neglected it. Moreover, under state auspices, its tombstones were continuously broken to pieces and used as construction material. The investigation Agram Ayvazyan conducted in the cemetery in 1971 and 1973 showed that it retained over 3,000 khachkars. Almost the same number was documented in 1987 when Dr. Murat Hasratyan and art historian Zaven Sarkisyan visited Julfa. In 1998, Nakhichevan's Azeri authorities started destroying the cemetery of Julfa with bulldozers to get rid of the countless Armenian monuments that attested to the Armenian identity of the territory and exposed the historical reality. Even UNESCO proved unable to prevent the annihilation of that part of Armenian cultural heritage. The photographs taken in autumn of 2002 revealed that the famous cemetery of Julfa did not have a single standing khachkar anymore. Having never been held accountable for these atrocities, the Azeri vandals resumed the destruction of the cemetery between the 10th and 14th of December 2005. With the complicity of their army, more than 100 soldiers, armed with heavy hammers and pickaxes, reduced the khachkars to a heap of crumbled pieces. The fragments were loaded onto lorries with excavators and thrown in the Arax facing side of the railway. Thus, in December 2005, the Azeri authorities finally attained the goal they had been pursuing for many years, the purging of the three hills of the khachkars. Many scholars and art historians from all over the world had the privilege of seeing, admiring, and studying the magnificent memorials of Julfa. However, both present and future generations have been stripped of the opportunity of enriching their spiritual knowledge through Julfa. Once again, this terrible crime is the handiwork of the Turks, or one of the Turkish tribes called Azeri. In 1170, Turkish Emir Yeltkuz burnt down more than 10,000 manuscripts in Babur region. In 1915, the Young Turks exterminated 1.5 million Armenians. Between 1998 and 2005, several thousands of khachkars were crumbled to pieces in Julfa. Regardless of the period, the Turks and their fellow tribesmen, the Azeris, continue causing horrific damage to the civilized world. In early March 2006, Nakhichevan's authorities stationed a military base in the site of Julfa Cemetery. How long are these barbarities to continue? Must we always be reminded of great writer Victor Hugo's prophetic words, "Devastation and mourning reign everywhere. The Turk has trod this land." Can we not put an end to this desecration once and for all?